All right, Shalom. This is Wyndham Alonso Teferi, reporting for LOJ Society on Rastafari Fellowship. Today is Wednesday, August 10th, 2016. It's 8:06 p.m. All right. So we're going to go into My Life and Ethiopia's Progress, Autobiography of Edamame Haile Selassie. This is page 296. So we're not going to read the whole thing, just what's relative to our objective lesson. So basically, towards the end of an address to the League of Nations, 11th Gembot 1928, that's to say the 19th of May 1936, in Jerusalem. Towards the end of this address, it reads, "And now we request that the League of Nations should not cease the strenuous efforts to have the covenant honored, and that it should not recognize claims of sovereignty or of territorial expansion through improper military force in breach of treaty obligations." This was addressed to the Secretary General of the League of Nations at Geneva. It begins by saying, "We would request you to make known on our behalf the following to member governments." Now, having said that, let's see, this has been coming up oftentimes now during this season, during these times. Wyndham Tobia brought it forth on the DSR Discipleship Radio. Wyndham Yaron's been, bringing it forth, and I've been bringing it forth, just not, communicated in English. But there's a lot of information that I and I actually have concerning what we're about to go into, the which we have not actually brought forth in English. So let's begin by saying this: in action. Throughout history, it has been the inaction of those who could have acted, the indifference of those who should have known better, the silence of the voice of justice when it mattered most, that has made it possible for evil to triumph. The glorious pages of human history have been written only in those moments when men have been able to act in concert to prevent impending tragedies. By the actions you take, you can also illuminate the pages of history." So now, His Majesty says that the League of Nations should not, should not, what was it? Recognize claims of sovereignty or of territorial expansion through improper military force in breach of treaty obligations. Now, what are we talking about? Well, fascist Italy, Benito Mussolini's, Victor Emmanuel's, and the Vatican Rome's invasion of Ethiopia in their hopes to establish a new Roman Empire on top the ruins of the ancient Hebrew Christian or Judeo-Christian kingdom, on which authority the which authority rests on the throne of King David, which is the throne of God on earth through Solomon and Queen Makeda of Ethiopia. So His Majesty is very clear: you should not recognize. And if ones are familiar with the Bible, then it requires two or three witnesses for truth to be sustained. Haile Selassie first, and Ethiopia, faithful Ethiopia, imperial Ethiopia, witness and testify that no recognition should be allotted to Rome, to the Vatican Rome in Italy, due to improper military conquest, which is in turn no conquest at all. But this claim is not, it's not authoritative, because you need a second witness. Otherwise, it can't. I mean, the heavens and earth testify to truth, but in the flesh, there must be another witness. Now, Jesus Christus came to bring salvation to the individual. His Majesty brings in the kingdom. That's to say, salvation at the highest level of human government. That's to say, salvation within a people, within a country, a nation. So, Jesus Christos, love thy brother as thyself, thy neighbor as thyself. His Majesty, love thy country neighbor or neighbor country as thyself. Same commandment, different authority, different levels. So now, let us say this one more time. Throughout history, it has been the inaction of those who could have acted, the indifference of those who should have known better, the silence of the voice of justice when it mattered most, that has made it possible for evil to triumph. Luckily, there was one voice that spoke on behalf of Ethiopia and sustained that claim throughout the war and continued faithfully throughout many years, although just like Ethiopia, Mexico too has fallen to the state of corruption, but that doesn't negate the fact that they did speak in truth and in spirit when it was most required of them. As a matter of fact, when no one else dared to speak against the circumstances. As a matter of fact, interestingly enough, Mexico at that time had no relations with Ethiopia whatsoever, yet Mexico did have strong ties to the Roman Catholic Vatican and Italy, but still decided to speak truth. On the basis that when they joined the League of Nations, they did it, under the assumption that it was an actual possibility. It was possible that through this league, peace, international relative peace, could be obtained. So, anyways, we're going to use two documents, at least for this presentation. We're going to skim through one real quick. And because it only has portions of what I think we could find a lot of this on this other document that I'm going to use mostly. So it begins by saying the history after the attack of the Ethiopian sovereignty by the Italian armed forces in 1935, the Assembly of the League of Nations responded according to the provisions of the agreement of the organization decreeing the implementation of economic Italian government sanctions. But after the agreements of the governments of England, France, and Italy outside of the League, the same organization was transformed into an instrument to subjugate the Italian claims to Ethiopia. We were informed, the emperor recalls, by our delegates who had taken the decision to call on all countries to vote on the proposed recommendation to the delegates. And we had the feeling that everyone was inclined to betray Ethiopia concerning the lifting of sanctions. Mexico opposed the points of the proposal and withdrew from the meeting. The countries present were called in alphabetical order to vote. 44 voted in support of the lifting of sanctions. Ethiopia objected, and 4 countries abstained. Now, this takes us forward to what we had read. Those that abstained, basically, it really makes no difference because, like we read, the indifference of those who should have known better. So, they might as well just voted against His Majesty. But nonetheless, Mexico walked out because Mexico had said that, many would rather that we just leave and not fight the cause. But they said as long as there's, hope that within the League of Nations, to the extent that, we can assume that ones are actually trying to keep, the society or the League of Nations intact by at least worst case scenario, seeing to it that they do the least bit possible, that as long as they saw that then it was enough for them to continue, not for the League's sake, but in defense of Ethiopia. But when they called for a vote to remove sanctions, Mexico said basically this is where we draw the line. It's completely wrong, and just to participate in this is treason. It's completely immoral, and it's we're not going to participate. Voting is voting against Ethiopia, basically. Just being present is supporting this nonsense. And we have a lot more documentation that we could bring forth, but that's going to be like maybe later, because we have that like in a more we have to present that, you know, with a more broadened context because of the because it's so much information. So Ethiopia objected, and the sanctions were eventually lifted. But the thing is that Ethiopia needs a second witness, a second voice, you know, to validate their claims, because Bible law still applies. Two or three witnesses are needed. Now, in this case, Mexico walked out, but in the cases to which we have introduced that is necessary for the League of Nations not to recognize any kind of territorial expansion by the evil deeds of Vatican, Rome, and Italy, you know, in cases such as those, Mexico performed valiantly. So basically, let's see. On 19th June 1954, the Emperor Haile Selassie I makes a visit to Mexico and met with the Mexican leader Lázaro Cárdenas and was interviewed. Let's see, I'm gonna just really quickly just say something. Remember when Jesus Christos goes into, I mean, resurrects Lazarus? The reason why he was received with palm trees on when he was on the mule, I think. The reason he was or a big part of the reason why he was received in such a way, in Hosanna, Hosanna, you know, going into Jerusalem, was because of Lazarus. I don't know exactly what kind of pull, what kind of popularity Lazarus had, but Lazarus has everything to do why they praised Jesus Christos entering Jerusalem. As weird as it may sound, that's actually the case. You know, going to the Gospel of Saint John, and you know, they even verbalize it to the extent that because many knew that what he had done to Lazarus, he gained a lot of popularity. So Lazarus, I don't know what kind of influence he had in Jerusalem, but or if I do know, I forgot. You know, we study so many things, and you know, we present on so many things. You know, some things just don't stick. But we'll bring that forth like on the forward. But nonetheless, it's Lazarus' like cooperation in this and participation, instigation of this reception to Jesus Christus is so profound that even the priest, the priesthood. They said that they even say that we got to get rid of Lazarus. You know, Lazarus has a lot to do with this, you know. And if he didn't, what difference would it make to get rid of Lazarus if Jesus Christos is the target? Well, you know, there's something there. And if we have that information, probably in our notes, you know, we'll bring it forth. But it's all in the Gospel of St. John. So anyways, what we're trying to say is that because many heard of what he had done and resurrected Lazarus, a lot of people were kind of like, you know, into Jesus Christus, you know, during that period. So they received him in such a way. Now, what does that have to do with this? The thing is that, you know, the rock that had Mexico in a cave in the death that sealed them in darkness for quite a bit of time now, even though they had already become independent from foreign colonial powers, they were still struggling with interior affairs. And so it was the faith in the Virgin Mary and Christ Jesus that actually freed them, that removed that stone, that burden, and released them from the death. Now, I don't know a whole lot about it, but I think from 1910 to 1920 there was a revolution amongst Mexico, the peasant people, and then against the corrupt government. And for 6 further years, possibly 1920 to 1925, there was like a crusade, kind of like a war, like the battle continued, but this one was called the Christers, or the Cristeros, you know, I don't think there's a translation to that, but like in making reference to the Christ's many plural, but the Christers, I wouldn't know how to say that. There's actually no direct translation. But anyways, so after all of this, after this, they resurrected, and the government that was established is the government of Lazarus, Cárdenas. So it was because of that experience that when they went into the League of Nations, they were like in the spirit of being lawful. I'm not saying that Mexico's in the spirit, but I am saying that according to the law, they acted to the best that the law can bring forth in a man, and in this case, in a governmental, at the governmental level. And His Majesty is operating at that level, at the highest level of human government. And so this witness came forth, and it was made possible because of the resurrection from the corruption and death and fighting the war, and then what's it called? Well, establishing the government of Lazarus based on true principles, as far as the law could permit a man to elevate himself. According to the law, they were capable to bring forth witness that His Majesty later brought forth, and they themselves had received in grace testimony that is true because of their desire to keep to the law. And so I'm not going to speak on that anymore because there is so much information to bring forth concerning that, but just to give one's like an idea of what was taking place. And so during the League of Nations, they refused to be corrupted because they had just come out of that corruption themselves. And so I do have to say that I don't support Mexico, and I don't really care for Mexico. I'm not embarrassed if one's refer to me as a Mexican, on the basis that some people are just normal average humans, and due to the consideration that ones cannot comprehend what they cannot comprehend, then on the measure of just progressive communication, then if I am identified as such, then that's fine. I don't neglect any relation or anything like that, but the thing is that I and I as members of a new race, and this has to be received by, I would say, the lineage of society, because Christ, in light of His Majesty, has given ones given Wyndham Yaron the opportunity to kind of spearhead or be the head of the resurrection, even of Rastafari, having that spirit dormant or sleeping, asleep. And we mean the spirit of truth, which is Jesus Christus, and unless Rastafari receive it, then they praise not His Majesty. His Majesty glories in the Bible. The Bible is the word is made flesh, and Jesus Christus is that flesh, and so he must be resurrected pure and clean, perfect, free from sin. That's to say, His Majesty has to say, no, my life is an example of the Jesus Christus that I testify to in spirit and in truth, our Black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach. So, and then we would be in the first power of the Trinity. But if you're missing part of the Trinity, then there's no power to it. So the Word made flesh, Jesus Christus, that's the glory of His Majesty. It's inseparable one from the other. And so what we're saying, well, the lineage of the society has been given the opportunity to bring forth that revelation, because up until the present time, because of the fact that it had to be fulfilled according to the same word, then it had not been revealed. But now it is revealed, and first and foremost, the society actually has to recognize this. That, see, I'm gonna bring this up. Baptism, it begins with baptism. I'm not talking about physical baptism. I really don't care what ones decide to do, but just if you know scripture, then you would know what I'm talking about. But most probably don't. Not that they don't know scripture, but they won't be able to kind of like relate this to baptism. How does the Bible begin with baptism? Well, in the beginning, heaven and earth is created, and in the second verse already, the Spirit moves above the waters. And so the first baptism, behold, it that's what it's basically coming down to. The earth was void and formless, and and then behold, the Spirit, he sees an image of himself. He sees something that is himself. He cannot deny himself, and so he pulls one from out of the water. That's to say, a re what's it called? A new creation. And so that's what that is. And even to go forward to chapter 53, the book of the prophet Isaiah, it'll go into who hath received the ar to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed, you know, who hath believed our report. And then it goes on to give witness of led like a lamb to the slaughter. He opened not his mouth, like led to the slaughter before the shear of the sheep and all that kind of stuff, you know. He hath no form or comeliness that when we see him we should desire him. But the important thing is to recognize that to get the fullness of that, it's ones actually have to begin in chapter 52. And without doing that, you really won't get the fullness of what that scripture is really bringing forth, which is Scofield notes says the vicarious sacrifice of Christ, Jehovah or Yahweh servant. But you know, if you start at chapter 52, the book of the prophet Isaiah, verse 13, and we have a subtitle says Jehovah's or Yahweh servant marred and afterward exalted. But see, Jah splits and flips a work so that it's clean and pure, so that it's not left to the corruption of the flesh. What I mean is that, you know, you split the hoof and then you chew the cud. So basically, we're gonna first be told of what is last, so that first shall be last and last shall be first. That's to say, behold, my servant shall deal prudently, he shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. Yes, but the thing is that first one must be in the experience that is described afterward. But at the same time, it's one and the same, because when Yahweh Elohim, when he when we his servants become when he deals prudently with us and we be exalted and extolled and very high, then we become the curse. And it's what we're bringing forth. I and I is judgment, and judgment is not free, or the line of Judah society is not free from judgment. And this is where it begins. So you know, might as well bring it forth, because when John, he's the spirit, is over the waters that have no form or comeliness that we should desire, or that are, or let's see what it actually says, because what I said is from Isaiah chapter 53, but it's basically the same thing. It says, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Let there be light, and there was light, an agreement, you know, a Deuteronomy. That's what Deuteronomy is. It's the confirmation of things. It's the second I won't Ilnet, ilnet, truly, truly, you know. So, two or three witnesses, it ties in. Now, what is Zion saying? There's no form, there's no form or comeliness. You know, the earth is void, and I forgot the verse so quick. And the earth was without form and void. That's to say that this baptism is coming from a prior judgment. And so when Ninai is in the waters, there's no the earth has no form, it's void. And the thing is, when one is exalted, we become accursed. Now let's go into that. Let's explain that. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high, because man has a different idea of beauty, and because man is outwardly enticed, you know, through his sensual consciousness to pretend that something that is not is, he becomes corrupt himself, and that he cannot discern a spiritual truth. We must be bigger than we have ever been, greater in spirit, ampler in our crook, overcoming petty prejudices, you know. We must become members of a new race, overcoming petty prejudices, you know, owing our allegiance not to nations but to our fellow within the human community. Now, a lot of people say this, but you know, is it true? Would you believe that Jah worketh the work that even when they told you it, you would not believe? You know, because you know, all those that may appear to be don't have to be, and if they're not in the fullness, then they are not. And so, you know, it's like when Elijah goes before Jezebel, Jezreel, can't really remember who it is. It's Kings chapter. Let's see. Let's see if we could find this real quick. Jezebel. He goes before Jezebel, and she says, "So let the gods do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." Now the beginning says, "Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, 'So let the gods do to me.'" What does that have to do with this? Elijah's preaching to the wrong people. The clue is what Jezebel is saying: "Let the gods do to me. You're wasting your time. I have 7,000 faithful, and I have ones that I've called, but you neglect them because you're going after some people that claim to be Israel, but they have nothing to do with Israel. They told you very clearly, 'Let the gods do to thee.'" You know, so basically, it's because he doesn't know the word that he can't discern truth. So he thinks that in the flesh, Israel is who they are actually not, in spirit. And so you can't separate one from the other. If you are Israel in the spirit, you're in the flesh because the spirit abides in the soul of the flesh, or you in animates it activates the soul within the flesh. It's inseparable. So if I'm Israel in spirit, I'm in flesh too, because I abound in a fleshy tabernacle. It's impossible to see otherwise. You know, the things hidden belong to Jah Rastafari, and the things revealed to his children from generation to generation. You know, the glory of God is to conceal his word, and the glory of kings, the Kheper Nekhesh, is to seek out his word. So it all ties in. But basically Jah told Elijah, "Listen, why don't you eat some more? Why don't you study and read some more Torah? Why don't you learn a little bit more? Because your zealousness is not according to my will and way. You know, I have 7,000, but you don't recognize them because you're trying to convince some pagan people that got many gods, Jezebel and her followers." You know, he's sent to Damascus. Damascus isn't even a property. It's within the boundaries that could have been obtained by Israel, but at that time it's not Israel. And actually, you know, Elijah, he's told to anoint the king of Syria, if I'm not mistaken. What does that have to do with Israel? So just to give ones an idea, you know, and Elijah kind of he picks up where Elisha picks up where Elijah left off, but he does a better job because it's about progress, it's about learning and not making the same mistakes. Nonetheless, let's see another thing. The seed of Israel, the seed of Abraham. See, the seed is the same piercing that is from the beginning, which is the zakar, which is the memory. And so if the memory abides within an individual, that's because he's the seed. So it doesn't matter how or what appearance an Israelite that claims to be but is not has. If he's not in the fullness, then how could he be the preservation of that handed down from generation to generation? It doesn't work that way. Now, am I saying that those that we say are original are not? No, they are the likeness of the flesh of the truth. I'm not, you know, I know it's very, very comfortable with the truth, but it's a judgment. It's a new creation. To whom more is given, of them more is required, and so no one is free from judgment. You know, we all will be tried. How serious are you? And do you actually accept what is true? And then once would be sent, taking an appearance that's not comfortable for others to try ones, because that's just the way it is. You know, and that's actually what this is going into, because it may appear to be void and formless. It may appear to be no comeliness and no beauty that we should desire according to the flesh. But that's the recreation or the new creation. So behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. But then that same, you know, blessing becomes the curse, because then, you know, the natural man cannot perceive the spiritual matter, the spiritual reality. And so there's conflict. Now we can go forward, and it says basically, as many were astonished. At thee, his visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations, the kings shall shut their mouths at him, for that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider. Now there's a footnote according to where it says vestige was so marred, more than any man. It says the literal rendering is terrible. So marred from the form of man was his aspect, that his appearance was not that of a son of man, i.e. not human. The effect of the brutalities described in Matthew 26, verse 67, 68, chapter 27, verse 27 to 30, actually include the cursings in the book of Leviticus and the book of Deuteronomy. But here's where it gets kind of, tricky, because Jah is going to put everyone to test. So basically what it's saying is that the image and likeness of God in the flesh, in Yeshua HaMashiach, and then we see, you know, the confirmation in Edomar Selassie, that image has been so badly marred and bruised and deformed and you know, like beaten on and so terribly humiliated and disgraced, that the appearance of the Emperor King of Kings of Ethiopia is that of a, you know, his appearance is like less of a man, like not human, like maybe inferior. Now, do you begin to see the effects of how this ties in? So because he's a black man in the flesh, it's like, oh, but they're not, oh, but you know, well, you know, there's no beauty, no form, nor comeliness that we should desire, because the image of a black man has been reduced to in a state of less of a man, and all because of the experience. You know, the passion of Christ is the foretelling or the prediction of that which was to come to, you know, black Hebrew Israelites in the Americas in particular. Ina is not denying that at all. But then in the thing to be considered that has never been told and has never been seen, that is spoken of, is the fact that in there's a trial even to them, because now if there's got to be a counterbalance, there's got to be the fact that you know, then one cannot be elevated above the other. Greek and Jew both have proven to judge unrighteously. Man to man is so unjust. That's inevitable. So the reality is to receive and be able to discern in spirit and in truth what is beneficial to us. And so we must accept that everything is so confused that we are not to jump to conclusions based on that which we cannot really understand. But the evidence is completely contrary to any kind of 20 cents and continue in doubt. So that, you know, that basically becomes that. So when you're pulled out of the baptismal waters in Genesis chapter 1 verse 2, the image might not be to the expectation and might not satisfy the desire of the fallen world, but it's the spirit that testifies to the origin of that individual. And so, you know, you can't really separate one from the other, because it's tawahido, you know, just as it is today, it always has been. So, you know, just putting that out there, because it's necessary to do so. And why did I begin saying this? Well, because I'm very well aware of this, and I'm not saying this because I'm trying to even exalt Mexico. I really don't care about it, because then what do I tell all the faithful, true and faithful elect Rastafari that are scattered throughout all other areas and happen to speak Spanish, because they are to whom I minister. I don't minister to Mexico independently. I minister to every single true and faithful member of the family of Rastafari whom happen to speak Spanish. So if I'm, you know, if I'm exalting, if I'm, you know, like for some reason, you know, playing favorites and you know, pretending Mexico is any better than any other corrupt country, you know, what am I to say to all my brothers and sisters, like that most of them are outside of Mexico? Mexico is faithful too in some cases, but you know, it's not just limited to, you know, how many countries speak Spanish and are fellowshipping in truth. You know, what am I to say to them? That should I make them less? No, it's time to be members of a new race, so that we could be an exemplary character to the rest of humanity, and that they can see by example that it is possible to all be different, but at the same time be one, so that there be hope for the for humanity, and not to, you know, because the way it's going is like, you know, well, that's just what Aina has been called to do, you know, outside of the body of Christ, Christ's head on the throne that His Majesty has granted us as our inheritance, you know, we are to become a new man, you know, so, and that new man give hope to the rest of the world that it is possible to maintain a relative peace. So we then would be, you know, firstborn members of the congregation, or that's to say, like the General Assembly of the United Nations, really. So now, oh well, I say that because it so happens that Mexico will play this role. I have nothing to do with it, you know, because I didn't decree it, I didn't create it, I just testified to it. Now, says where'd we left off, let's see, but after the agreement, okay, we read that. Now let's see, not all were traitors, not all were cowards. It reads, in the dark hours when the minutes glide through one's hands, unable to stop the tragedy, when the beating heart resonates in the chest and the seconds dilate without giving respite between beats, a voice is raised in brave defense of the covenant and international law, breaking the circle of criminal silence, facing the ruthless conspirators and their cowardly accomplices' passive attitudes. Now that's enough for this document. We're gonna open up another one, and actually we've got so much more like information on this. It's pretty cool, pretty interesting. As a matter of fact, the president at that time of Mexico declared in the national newspaper. He called everyone in the League of Nations heartless cowards, you know, within the heart of the society or something like that, you know. But, you know, they were never at all abashed or ashamed or even, you know, like, sensitive about speaking truth. So it says, let's see. Now this is what we're going to read. It says, visit of Emperor Haile Selassie I or Edomar Haile Selassie to Mexico, June 19th, 1954, by Jesus and Zara Amlak. Written in 2007, Mexico Distrito Federal, Federal District, and we just utilize this to support, you know, the fellowship and all that. But and I forgot to mention that let's see. Oh, and evidence for this is you know, because ones have all the right to doubt. Evidence for this is that His Majesty commissioned or ordered that Mexico Square be erected in Ethiopia, in Addis Ababa. As a sign of just like being thankful, and plus so that it could serve as a symbolical, you know, like so that it could be like a sign of what really took place. And so you have Ababay Mexico or something like that, Mexico Square in Ethiopia, and you know, as a result of His Majesty visit to Mexico, then you have Plaza Ethiopia. They tore it down eventually, and now it's Metro Ethiopia. It's like a metro station, and you know, it's, the logo is a lion, and it's called Metro Ethiopia. And they have the original plaque. They set up this nice wall with what do you call that, like little lion head sticking out of the wall. What do you call that, I forgot the artistic expression. And then they have the original plaque that His Majesty granted Mexico, and just like informational plaques and all that. Every year the faithful, they gather and you know, chant and binky, and just memorialize that special day of the visit. And so, and it's funny because in Addis Ababa, Mexico Square was also torn down, and it also, I think if I'm not mistaken, they also turned that into a metro station. You know, well, stuff happens, you gotta adapt and modernize the roadways, and that's exactly what happened in Mexico. And they would have destroyed all evidence, but then you know, the Rastafari made sure that they preserved it. So now the street on top of the metro is Ethiopia Street, and then they have the plaque on the bottom with the an area dedicated to the visit and all that, commemorating the visit. and the station is called Metro Ethiopia. So, you know, that was brought forth and preserved. Now it says, let's see, we got 20 minutes. Welcoming Emperor Haile Selassie I of Ethiopia, Lion of Judah, and lover of freedom for the people, starting with his own, whom he freed from ancestral slavery as soon as he felt on his temples the imperial crown of Menelik II. Now, I remember, I remind ones that I'm actually borrowing this from, from individuals, because it's part of supporting Nainai cause, like I would for any Wendemuch or Ixhetoch within the Mahibra. So, Nainai have contemplated the visit of His Majesty as a historical fact of great importance. Spiritually, it has had great value that Haile Selassie I, or Ketamach Selassie, has visited the land where we were born. For the conquering line came to teach us, his children, the value, the true value of gratitude and loyalty. He introduced himself with real humility of heart to teach us the greatest feeling that can exist. Amor, jamor, it's kind of like the Hebrew amar. So, jah love, but in Christ, you know, and I have to remind them of that, and they don't like it either. So, you know, judgment is to all peoples. No one is freed from, you know, having to testify true or false witness to him that is true, has been, ever will be. Then came the Emperor of Ethiopia at 12:30 the hour on the plane Star of Ethiopia of the Trans World Airlines, and was welcomed by the Mexican president at the international platform of the new airport in Mexico City. His Majesty visited within the most important places, Ciudad Universitaria, Teotihuacan. Ciudad Universitaria, I think that's like a university. Teotihuacan is where the Mayan pyramids are at. The Hospital of La Raza, of the race, June 22nd. That's probably like a name of it too. Cuauhtémoc, that's like a Aztec name or something. It's Avenue, Cuauhtémoc Avenue. Avenue November 20th and Avenue May 5th. And Juarez Avenue and Reforma. Now the Emperor of Ethiopia stepped down from the device that led him into Mexico, accompanied by his son, Prince Haile Selassie, and his granddaughter, Princess Desta Seble, his Minister of War, General Brigadier Abeye Abebay, the Minister of Justice, and his Imperial Seal, Sahafi Tezas Johannes or Wolde Johannes Wolde Georges or Georges Wolde, Foreign Minister, his Ahiu or Aheu Tekle Wolde. Now, you know, forgive I not for the pronunciations of the names. Most likely the vocalization was not exact because it's in English or Spanish letters, and therefore, you know, I can't get the actual vowel pointing as to how to pronounce it properly. So anyways, accompanied by his royal entourage, that's to say i.e. the army of angels of blood and fire, the emperor descended from the heights, leaving traces of his goodness, which can still be perceived to have in my hands a document, as it is in the case of this newspaper, directly sharing with us his wise words. The spirit of the great men form the unity of nations and support the libertarian desire of the people, and therefore it is necessary to worship them and remember their deeds to the glory of humanity. And showing the enormous ease with which he thanked the Mexican people, and I indoctrinated on how you should thank him. And I tell them, you know, well, it's to learn for thyself how to serve the Creator, and in taking this responsibility, you would inevitably learn the way to serve your fellow brother and sister within the human community. That is to say, you know, glory to Jah. How could we glorify Jah but to do his will? And is to do his will is to, you know, receive the fact that the Bible is the rallying point to all humanity. That's his glory. The Word, and the Word is made flesh, and we got to receive Jesus Christus in spirit and truth. So, our God, and you know, shared mutual esteem for our Mexico, pronouncing to us in a whole and unreservedly, we share with Your Excellency the hopes expressed that our direct knowledge effectively contributes to closer relations that blessed and joyfully exist between our two nations. I now give thanks for the revelation. Fortunate we are to have received on this earth the presence and witness of the eye in the flesh. We are here contemplating coming days under his own hand, and we've explained this to them that no, you know, I and I should be coming, you know, and read the Bible so that the Spirit of Christ and truth can come, and then we could get this going. But otherwise, you know, it's not going nowhere. Because we are his hand, his authority upon earth. you know, but there's a protocol. With faith in Jah, well, we're the we are faith, you know. So let's see, Rastafari, who said in his glorious visit, their dignified and humanitarian feelings and unanimous will and have encouraged and moves this heroic people because it knows what it takes to achieve freedom and does not ignore the value to preserve it. It desires it, it defends it, and that to everyone equally. His Majesty said he sees Mexico as the older brother of Latin America, and that Mexico and Ethiopia seem much alike geographically and historically. He had read a lot about Ainai country, but what I have now had the opportunity to observe, this is the emperor speaking, leaves far behind what I knew through books. Yeah, it begins in the Bible, but then, you know, we live it in truth. And it's that much more beautiful. It's that first power of the Trinity. Therefore, I and I have a great responsibility on our shoulders. That's the cross, the government that we have inherited to build through spiritual and physical effort, a strong nation and morally disciplined. What's the discipline? It's being disciples of who? Of Jesus Christus, our Black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, says Jah Rastafari, God, our God. Then we must make the valiant effort not to lose the title by which His Majesty honored us. You know, millions of... Your Majesty, millions of Christians throughout the world regard you as the reincarnation of Jesus Christ. His Majesty said, I've heard of that idea. I've also met certain Rastafari. His Majesty is not one not to pay attention. The question was, there are millions of Christians, Your Majesty, that regard you as the, around the world that regard you as the incarnation of Jesus Christ. His Majesty said, I've heard of this idea, but you must be talking about Rastafari. I've also met certain Rastafari. So he's called us by a new name, and we must not, you know, lose that title that he has given Ainai. So referring to the participation of Ethiopian women in the active life of the country, the emperor said that the extent where it can develop its activity, women are involved in the life of the nation. That means that's to say in everything. And said he himself is the son of a queen of Ethiopia. That's to say, you know, God is not, man is not emanated from a deity. Nothing's going to pop out of the sky. Man is born of a woman, and so it is, and so it shall be. Anything else is you know, false philosophy. After these words, Haile Selassie first, let us see his unfathomable fairness with regard to mankind, the role of Alpha and Omega in the progress of the Ethiopian nation. Our nation, the new flower, Addis Ababa, is paramount. He said once again that his visit to Mexico did not respond to commercial purposes. The Negus Negesht said the Mexican aid manifested in this way. I do not guide coming. I'm not guided coming to... my coming here is not guided. My coming to Mexico was not guided other than the desire to acknowledge the cooperation this worthy of its worthy representation provided to my country during the League of Nations, or in the League of Nations, when put to the discussion the aggression suffered by my country in 1935, and that relations between Mexico and Ethiopia did not start the day of his visit, but 20 years ago, when Mexico, a country lover of freedom par excellence, defended the Ethiopian Empire. Says generous gratitude that the emperor gave to the Mexican people by the manifested behavior in the League of Nations to defend from the fascist Italy of Mussolini to Ethiopia, where our father loves to be. He loved the gates of Zion, you know, more than all the dwellings of Jacob. So it says, which Jah Almighty defended me, where he loves to be, father loves to be, which Jah Almighty defended being you know, Yahweh Lord of Hosts, led the battle at front, an invasion that in the eyes of Mexico, totally unjust and without fear or doubt, he defended before the mighty powers in question. Without any economic agreement between Mexico and Ethiopia, the meeting gave a clean way without a doubt to the royal visit of the emperor. The royal visit of the emperor is to us the manifestation of his mercies and kindness. The Lion of Judah shall break every chain. Continues. Let's see, we got like 10 minutes. Hope we can finish this up. Let's see, it shall break every chain. All nations will be against the Lamb, but the Lamb shall overcome them, because he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I've been through this. I've never seen no documentation where His Majesty is giving the title Lord of Lords. He is the King of Kings, which is superior to Lord of Lords. If anything, Lord of Lords belongs to our Black Lord and Savior Jesus Christus. Blessed be him that cometh in the name of the Lord. That's to say, Haile Selassie first, you know, defeats his enemies, making them his footstool. That's to say, the Lord, the name in which he comes, in Jesus Christus. This is what makes me want to follow Jesus Christ. So now it says, let's see, where are we? Okay. For I and I quote, reproduced below the speech of His Majesty Haile Selassie I, Charles de Farah, as a guest of Mexico on June 19th, 1954. Mr. President, the eloquent words just expressed by Your Excellency, referring to the President of Mexico, Ruiz Cortines, reach deep, but is not the first of the pleasant emotions we have experienced since our arrival in Mexico, or certainly the last. Demonstrations of cordial sympathy with which we are received by your people, by their spontaneity, indubitable testimony, and thus an expression of both nations, determined in such cases by the similarity, and in others by the identity of feelings, and even the topography of the two countries, as with which fairness thou hast, Your Excellency, expressed. We are on our own land, that's to say, we feel at home. The words of His Majesty, so he goes on to say, you have said, Mr. President, that you wish that our stay in your country during this visit, eagerly awaited for so long a time, be an enjoyable one. And to them we do answer how cordial and sincere wishes are now a realization fully achieved. What we have seen so far, and what your wonderful country and its institutions, its customs and feelings, we know from various and reliable conducts, make us not feel as in a strange land when we are in yours. Now the following, translation, we kind of just went over it real briefly using Google, you know, Translate. We didn't spend any time on this, so we're probably going to have to improvise in some cases. We just, you know, got bored. I think we erased the original translation. President, the fraternal and viral action of the people of Mexico and the League of Nations in defense of the sacred rights of Ethiopia, unknown and calculated for no reason other than force and the other reasons that never confessed avid expansionism, nor they justified, because they were always shameful and impossible to justify, Mexico's champion efforts or struggle in such tragic moments of our ancient history and critical to our national life as a state with more than 30 centuries of sovereign and independent existence. The voice of Mexico rose again as generous and courageous, letting it heard in the tribunal of the world to defend as striven champions the House of Ethiopia, and with it of reason, truth, justice, and law. And although they do not have the same impact and effectiveness of holiness that the defended cause deserved, not because it was lost in the void, then floating in the room were his words, expression of feeling of a people convinced that there is a God in heaven and imminent justice cannot allow continuity, thus tolerate the persistence of coming to consolidate unjust acts clearly contrary to the most elementary norms of universal moral and incompatible with the simplest requirements for a peaceful international coexistence. We don't know if we're going to finish, probably, maybe not, but we have to add, there's another document where His Majesty basically says, you know, in the most difficult times of our life, you know, when we pretty much had lost hope, you got to remember His Majesty's still man. And so, you know, so this is how important it is, even God being a man, he receives from a breath of life. And that's what he said, that the voice of Mexico gave him hope that there is something good on earth still, and Mexico was able to do that because they saw themselves on the cross like John did, you know, next to Mary. So John and Mary, you know, Johannes and Mariam. And from that day on, you know, Juan took Mary as her mother, and you know, no other place in the world has a revolutionary flag that I know of been raised carrying the image of Dengle Mariam, you know, Ediste Dengle Mariam. But that in Mexico, in the revolution to be freed from colonization, and in the revolution to overthrow the corrupt government. So all that's pretty interesting. Now, let's see. Mexicans desire and defend freedom. And, you know, in in Amharic, Beamarnia, Meskin, I think it's Meskin or Meskin, Meskin, that actually translates to poor, so blessed are the poor. Because they said, and to those that oppose our stance, they say, are we not a backward, black, non-Christian, non-Catholic, non-European, like no good, retarded, backward people? Yes, we are. Do we have, are we cultured? Are we like civilized? Do we have, means of power, economics, and all that? No, we don't. So to allow this to happen without raising our voice is to condemn ourselves to the same future. So even though they were only acting in according to the law, they were able to bring forth a true and faithful witness, So according, let's see, of their dignified and humanitarian sentiments and the unanimous will that move me and encourage this historic people, remember that Genesis for chapter 1 verse 2, because it knows what it takes to achieve freedom and has not ignored to keep it, want it, and defend it for everyone equally. Accordingly to these friendly acts and noble liberal traditions that have won you worldwide fame and esteem, Mexico, through its illustrious and distinguished Foreign Minister Luis Padilla Nerbo, has acted once again as a friend of Ethiopia at the United Nations to support a highly prestiged ratification on behalf of a century of injustice and meeting the brothers of Eritrea and Ethiopia under one banner, undying friendship between the two peoples. Let's see, it was when Mr. President, it was when deeply moved by the attitude of the government of the people of Mexico, we were set since that day onward to come to your country that our presence make known the feelings towards this that towards you has filled our heart, something like that. And everyone and each and every one of our subjects, and to assure the undying friendship since then and forever unites our people with yours. Your history is so full of glorious historical facts and the heroes that have surrendered the most fervent and sincere tributes, and the violent movements that have so profoundly removed the social and political structure of this privileged country are, Mr. President, source of inspiration for many nations. A speech at the National Palace of His Majesty Haile Selassie I. These are fragments. It says here, one, these are notes, I guess, footnotes. We use the word brothers in Ethiopia to refer to Mexico and Mexicans, as we cannot forget fraternal and viral action and defense of the rights of our country, Ethiopia. Two, Mexico's voice was heard on the highest podium of the world's championed struggle to defend the cause of Ethiopia, and with it, of reason, truth, justice, and law. Three, Mexico never wanted to recognize and never recognized any accomplishment, attributed to Italy, because it would have meant the denial of the principle that it has always defended. So, we give thanks. We're gonna end it up with that. We got a lot to say, but probably take a while to bring.